Hello, everyone. I'm Tanya Fitzpatrick with World Footprints. For the Vatican and the city of Rome, Holy Week has been eerily quiet. The thousands who generally flock to St. Peter's Square have stayed away because of COVID-19 pandemic. Yet, the Pope will be celebrating all services on his own with no audience. And the Vatican's offices remain open even though there's been confirmed coronavirus cases, but social distancing is also taking place. Voice of America reporter Sabina Castelfranco has been covering the coronavirus pandemic's impact on Italy and the Vatican, and she joins us now from Rome. Sabina, thank you.
My pleasure.
So, Italy is in its sixth week of the coronavirus struggle. The country has seen over 115,000 cases, nearly 14,000 deaths, yet the government is planning to end the lockdown next week. Is that premature?
The government will not lift the lockdown next week. It's becoming increasingly clear that this is not going to happen at all. In fact, what's not clear is when it's going to happen and how it's going to happen, because the government keeps saying there's going to be a phase two. That phase two does not mean that everybody just goes back to their life and business as usual. What that phase two means is that certain businesses and companies will open up first, and so certain people will be allowed to go probably back to work. And some of these people will probably be the ones that have either tested negative or with some further testing, it will be clear that they are immune or safe to go back to work. However, this whole strategy is still unclear. There's a lot of uncertainty here in Italy. There's also very little optimism at this stage because, as you said, it's been a number of weeks now and people have been in their homes and behaving very well, I have to say. And so they want to know, they're getting restless and want to know what's going to happen next. I mean, we've all been told that when we do go out, we will only be going out wearing our protective masks and our protective gloves, and social distancing will continue. And it's not like we're gonna go back to our cafes and our restaurants and all mingle together and have these large big meetings. That's not gonna happen.
You know, a lot of us across the globe were really surprised to see how quickly the coronavirus spread through Italy. What do you think attributed that rapid and deadly spread?
Well, there's been a number of things up in the north of Italy, which is apparently where it all began in this country. There was a very big Champions League soccer game in Milan, where 40,000 people from Bergamo, traveled to Milan and took part in that game. And many others watched the game with their friends and families at home in Bergamo. And one of the main people who died in the very beginning was from that area. And it is believed that carried that the virus to the soccer game, and many people were infected there. Another issue is that where in the initial areas where the virus infected people, it also infected many of the doctors in the hospitals because they were not prepared to deal with the issue. And so many doctors were carrying it without knowing it, or were possibly asymptomatic and were in the hospitals, and as they were working, basically infecting other people. So the situation quickly got way out of control in the north of the country, and that's where we've seen the biggest problems happen, also because certain areas that should have been locked down were not locked down. Initially, only 11 towns were locked down in Lombardy and one in Veneto. Veneto actually reacted much better than Lombardy. And in fact, that's mainly to do with the fact that very early on, a virologist in the area was able to understand that when there is many infected people, up to 50% and maybe even more than 50% of those infected are in fact showing no symptoms and need to be locked down as well.
Well, speaking of lockdown, you know, normally, I mean, I envision the Vatican really being its own self-contained lockdown, really. So surprised to learn that there were cases of the coronavirus within the Vatican walls. How is the Pope being protected, and how do you think that happened? I mean, how could that have happened with no visitors really being allowed in?
Well, there's a lot of people who work inside the Vatican who are Italian, employees of the various different Vatican offices within the Vatican walls, and they go to work every day inside the Vatican, go in through one of the entrances, be it the one called Sant'Anna or on the other side of the Vatican, and that there's a number of ways in from Italian territory. And, you know, these people obviously mingle also with priests who live inside the Vatican. And so that's probably how that happened. The Pope is being very well looked after. And in fact, he no longer has his meals in the Santa Marta residence where he lives with other people. Now he stays in his room, and the tray with his food is taken to him. Also, he keeps a social distance when he meets with the 2-3 people he meets every day. Obviously, the meetings with the Pope have diminished for his many services, because this is such a, how would I put it, unique, rare, strange, weird Holy Week.
All of the above, yes.
Yeah, all of those together. So the Pope will be celebrating all his services, as you said. But of course, he does not have an audience, and most of those services are being held inside St. Peter's Basilica with very few collaborators. Only one service this year will be held not inside the Basilica, and that will be the Way of the Cross on Friday. The Way of the Cross normally is celebrated with a candlelit procession in the Colosseum on Good Friday. Well, that's not gonna happen, and nor are the tens of thousands of people who usually take part in that event going to go. So it'll be the Pope on his own in St. Peter's Square for the Way of the Cross on Friday evening.
And I'm sure this will be, certainly parts will be televised so that Catholics around the world and Christians around the world can enjoy.
Tanya, everything will be televised from, you know, the beginning to the end. It will be televised so that the faithful from all over the world will be able to watch it live. In addition, it will be streamed on the internet. So, you know, everybody will be able to see it. And obviously, you know, the newscasts will cover it. You know, there will be huge coverage, particularly because this is so strange to be seeing. And believe me, I have covered the Vatican for 30 years. And believe me, to see St. Peter's Square like that, it's kind of like hurts your soul, your heart, everything.
And, you know, speaking of strange, I mean, I'm sure even to see the streets of Rome, you know, I mentioned there, everything is eerily quiet. What is that like for you as a resident of Rome?
Well, it's on one side, it's heartbreaking, you know, to see, you know, you feel like all life has left the alleys of Rome, the streets of Rome. And yet, there's also beauty. There's a side of it that I think, when as I was walking around yesterday, because I was working and had to go and take photos of the various landmarks of Rome. And so I went and I saw the Colosseum like I've never seen it before, with not one single tourist, and the Trevi Fountain with not one single tourist. And I could actually hear the birds chirping, and I could, you know, hear the water from the Trevi Fountain that I'd never heard before. I mean, I'm from Rome. I've lived in Rome all my life. And, you know, I never thought I would ever, ever experience something like what I experienced yesterday, as I went from one monument to another, and there was no one there except police cars making sure that people were not out. And the only other the only other thing I saw was, you know, the buses that, you know, are still working, you know, the regular buses in Rome, but of course there's no people in there, but they still have to run.
Now, I want to shift a little bit and talk about some of the disparate groups that are being impacted by this coronavirus, the homelessness, the migrant populations. How are those people being served and protected?
Well, there's a lot of, you know, associations, charitable organizations, volunteers that are helping out, the church itself. But today, you know, actually last night, the government signed a new decree in which closing all of our ports to any charity ship coming in with migrants. This happened because there was a German vessel that had just picked up, rescued 150 migrants, African migrants in the Mediterranean, and was looking for a safe port. And so Italy said that all ports are closed because they are not safe. At this moment with the coronavirus emergency, there is no boat that can be can basically dock in our ports. And this is gonna be the situation at least until the 31st of July, which is when the current emergency is meant to end. However, that deadline could of course be extended without any problem.
Okay. Do you think, Sabina, that this virus, at least in Italy, I know it has in other countries, but in Italy, has it raised a different level of social consciousness? Will it change societal norms in Italy? And will it spark political questions now going forward?
I think it certainly has gotten a lot of people thinking of, you know, how lucky they were and what they could do and, you know, the freedom that they had. And maybe that appreciation that of things you took for granted every day. And so now maybe you appreciate more and you will go back to your new life, realizing that you have to be careful and you have to also understand what you have and appreciate what you have. And yes, I think it has posed a lot of questions in whether our legislators, our politicians, our, you know, authorities have done the right thing. You know, I was listening to the mayor of Rome today saying that Romans have reacted very well, that they have done, you know, they have stayed at home, that, you know, even there are fines, obviously, if you go around Rome without a valid motivation and if you get stopped. I mean, yesterday as I was working, I got stopped more than once. And you just can't go around walking around as if, you know, everything is normal. But I do think it has raised questions as to how the authorities reacted, and particularly whether there were a certain amount of delays in the beginning because maybe they just did not understand how serious this was.
Speaking of communities, talk about the communities that have come together, the neighbors who are helping neighbors, you know, the acts of kindness that have arisen because of this virus.
Well, there's been a lot of that, particularly using social media, actually. There's been groups, you know, which I actually belong to as well, to help, you know, basically to donate, but not only to donate, to help the hospitals and the staff, you know, the health workers, but also to help people who cannot buy food. I mean, so many people are in difficulty at the moment, or even the elderly who cannot leave their homes. So there are groups that have come together to, you know, with volunteers who will actually purchase your food for you, take it to your home, whether you are, you know, an elderly person or whether you just cannot afford that food. And then, of course, there's a lot of solidarity with, you know, health workers. We've lost 95 doctors in Italy because of coronavirus, and thousands of other health workers. So particularly in the north, the situation has been very, very difficult, not only in the health areas, but also with people having to deal with the number of dead. There's also some groups that provide psychological assistance now. There were situations where the hospitals didn't know where to put the dead. You know, when we had so many dead, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds every day, and the crematorium in the north just couldn't deal with it, and the cemeteries couldn't deal with the numbers. And in addition to all that, their families couldn't see their loved ones once they were dead, and they couldn't even bury them because funerals are banned in this country and will probably be banned for quite some time. So it's all been very difficult in that respect.
So, you know, we've seen the images of rooms filled with coffins. We've seen examples of what you've just shared. What's happening with those bodies, with the bodies of the deceased?
Well, they are going to the crematoriums, and, you know, they had to close Milan's main crematorium, but now things are easing off now. Things are getting better. We've had the numbers are decreasing in the number of dead. We had a significant drop even yesterday. I think that this year we're going to see the numbers of dead dropping even further. The numbers of infected are dropping. So things are looking good. The light is there at the end of that tunnel. However, you know, people need to understand here, it's not, you know, that we go back to how it was. And although it's only been since the 21st of February, you know, I think there's a long way to go. And you know, I'd like to make that clear, not, you know, to other countries as well, because this is what's going to happen in other countries as well. We were the first in Europe, and certainly we didn't obviously learn our lessons enough from China, from Wuhan. But now Wuhan is open again. So if Wuhan is open again, that means we'll be open again at some stage as well. I think what the authorities are really scared of here is not opening up too fast, because they don't want to risk new infections and then starting over all over again. I mean, you know, here it's now April, the weather outside is absolutely fantastic. People would be in the piazzas now and playing, the children in the street. The weather is really, it's very sunny and warm, and people can't leave their homes. I think people are suffering with that. Italians are suffering. You know, Italians are used to being passionate, hugging each other, kissing each other, doing all this stuff. And now they, you know, they can't do that. But I think that they realize that if they just hold on tight for a little while longer, and I think really maybe mid-May, I mean, mid-May things should look much better, I think.
We can only pray that it will. You know, we talk a lot about the people on the front lines. You know, the doctors, the grocery clerks, the sanitation workers, the cleaners, and they all are. But so are reporters. You Yes. are on the front line covering all of these stories. How are you protecting yourself, and what creative ways have you adopted to cope with this, with the restrictions of this pandemic?
Well, you know, when this whole thing happened, I had to go to England to pick up my sons who study there. So when I came back to Italy, I was put in quarantine for 2 weeks without being able to leave the house. And that means not even for food. So we did not leave, the three of us. We reported the fact that we had returned from another country to the health authorities, the local health authorities, and we were quarantined, and our food was being delivered to us. I'd order it and they'd be delivered. And that's what happened for the first 2 weeks. And then obviously I've been out after that to the grocery store. You don't go to the grocery store without a protective mask here. That's out of the question, and without gloves. And in addition, when you go inside, you disinfect those gloves. That's like compulsory. Or put on another pair of gloves, plastic ones that they give you at the grocery store. And then you can throw those out when you leave. I certainly wash my hands a lot. I also do not go anywhere without a protective mask. It would be just criminal to do that because you don't know who you're gonna meet. And I'm a journalist, I'm a reporter. I obviously could bump into anybody, but even just the police official, you know, as you said, this is like the health workers, the police officials, they're in the front line. They talk to people. So, you know, I try to keep a social distance. And I do, as I said, wear a protective mask. I wear the gloves. I disinfect. When I come home, sometimes I try to leave my shoes out of the house and take off my clothes and get into the shower when I get home. Mm-hmm. And, you know, so far so good. And let's hope, you know, somehow I think not everybody gets it for some reason. Although, you know, you can't rely on your lucky stars, of course, because what we've seen in this country has been unbelievable. But I'm sure that there are some people who are, you know, just like when you get the flu, some people get it easier than others. And maybe this coronavirus also affects certain people more than others. Certainly in this country, it has affected elderly people a lot because they already had other ailments. And so that was one of the big problems here.
So after this pandemic is lifted, maybe May, a little bit after that, what's the first thing, Sabina, you're going to do or the first place you'll go? What are you longing for?
I want to go to the beach. The weather is so good. No, yeah, I mean, my sons, I'd like them to go out. The other thing is, like, here, even the parks have been closed, so we can't even go for a run. If we, you know, now they're saying, well, maybe if you just want to walk around your block, that's fine. But, you know, we really are at home. So I'd like to go out there and breathe the air, you know, in an open space. I don't need to be right next to a lot of people. I mean, I'm kind of like a social person, but I'd also, you know, one thing I didn't appreciate ever, but, you know, going to the cafe to have my espresso coffee, you know, I'd like to go to the cafe again and get an espresso. I can't do that. All the bars and cafes are closed, you know, and yeah, I can have an espresso at home, but, you know, that's kind of a very Italian thing to do. Mm-hmm. You know, the only places you could go at the moment is the grocery store or the pharmacy, you know, that's kind of like, or, you know, and, you know, I shouldn't complain. I'm one of the lucky ones, you know, I'm a reporter. And so I'm allowed to go out, but, you know, going out, you also have to look after yourself. It's not like you're going to go out and just party and meet with friends. I mean, I haven't seen any of my friends for some time, although I have to say that thank goodness for, you know, the internet and social media, because that's the way that we all keep in contact. And that's how you and I can talk now.
Indeed. Well, grazie, Sabina. Be safe, stay well, and we look forward to hearing from you again soon.
Yes, Tanya, you're welcome to call me whenever you like, and you guys look after yourselves too.